إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، all praise is due to Allah, we praise Him abundantly. And we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace and send His blessings and His salutations upon the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and upon his companions and his wives and all those who follow them on their path of righteousness until the day of recompense. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu attaqu allaha wa qulu qawlan sadida yuslih lakum a'malakum wa yaghfir lakum dhunubakum wa man yuti' allaha wa rasulahu faqad faza fawzan azima. O you who have believed, fear Allah and be mindful of Him and say that which is correct and straight. Allah Azza wa Jal accordingly will rectify your affairs and will forgive you your sins. And whosoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has attained the greatest form of success. Brothers in Islam, the war which we are going through now is ancient. It's an ancient war. And no, I am not referring to the military war, because political discussions are often fruitless and only stir emotions and trials and tribulations with no result or evil results. I'm speaking about a much more fundamental, foundational war. A war that has existed from the time Adam was created and Satan became his enemy. It is the manifestation of the war between the truth and the falsehood. It has always existed and it will exist until the end of time. Only in the life to come it will come to an end. Only in the life to come, when the residents of paradise enter paradise and the inhabitants of hell enter hell, and it's all said and done, only then this war will end. As of now, it will not end. It cannot end. It only changes forms. There's a lot of deceit involved in it. A lot of acting involved in it. The characters change. The theme changes, the settings change, but the essence of the war does not change. It is everlasting as far as we're concerned in this worldly life. And we see it on so many fronts in so many ways. Some of them are blatant in your face type, and some are subtle and done in a very deceitful, disgusting way. And in recent times, and as usual, we saw a manifestation of one of those subtle ones. The ones that very few people spot, and they only spot them because of knowledge. While the ignorant continue to get distracted by these news and become among those who circulate it. And instead of the fitna being limited to a small number of people, it encompasses the whole ummah because of some ignorant heads who have not learned what they're supposed to learn, who read the Quran but don't understand, who hear the hadith but don't implement. So what is your stance and position in regards to that? And on which side of the coin are you? And which group do you represent? Did you get involved in this fitna? The fitna
of moving the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from where it is to Al-Baqi'. The fitna that the disbelievers spread for the fourth consecutive year now, 2011, 2012, 2013, 2014. Same garbage, different day. Isn't it time that we have learned that this is nonsense? Isn't it time that we have learned that this is an agenda for the people who can't stand the peace and security that we enjoy in this country? If I were and you were to go back to our respective homes, what is awaiting us over there? No need to answer. We all have an answer. Allah knows what. Depending on the country, what type of trials, what type of fitna, what type of war, what type of killing, lack of security, robbery, shirk, you name it. All types of calamities. Except for some minor other destinations. Where else do we get to enjoy the peace and security that we have except here? And I am not a nationalistic person calling for some patriotic kind of act or anything of the sort. No. I am referring to the land where Islam survives as it's supposed to. Perfection is not on earth. Nor am I claiming perfection in everything we see around us. Plenty of faults, of course. But the intelligent one knows how to weigh things out. We admit to the mistakes, but we also see the good. The good which many people don't see. Or they see but they don't want us to see. Or they see and they want to remove it from existence. So that this place becomes like the neighboring ones. So that the Muslims will finish each other off. And then the disbelievers will simply take whatever they've been wanting to take for many years. It's an agenda. And many are foolish to buy into that stuff and become propagators and call to all kinds of nonsense against the very place in which they enjoy the peace and security. And who are we serving? And what objective are we fulfilling? And what benefit are we reaping? The person will not understand what is being said until the security goes away. And then he will say, maybe it was wiser for some people to have kept quiet. Maybe the sunnah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam repeatedly told the Sahaba in regards to their relationship with the rulers, then the people will understand its value and application. How you deal with the people in charge. It is not bravery that you stand on the minbar and you incite the people against the rulers, causing thereafter fitna between the rulers and those whom they're responsible for. That would only lead to disasters. And you will not get your way. The person in charge is not waiting for the khutbah when you blast him for him to change his ways. You will only bring calamities upon your fellow brothers. And you haven't accomplished anything. You're brave, that's nice. Had it been with the sunnah, and according to the sunnah, we would say, Barakallahu feek, move on. But unfortunately, it's against the sunnah. The hadith explicitly says, that if the people in charge were to lash you, and take your money oppressively, give it to them and keep quiet, Allah will give you your right back on Yawm Al-Qiyamah. Not every time you don't like something, you want to revolt and protest and do all kinds of nonsense. They tried it elsewhere, look what we have today. It became regular news that a person here, his uncle died, his cousin died, his grandmother died, it's regular news. They were bombed, they were shot. What benefit? And the people there are still there. Or the person who was evil was removed and a more evil person came instead. Do we not understand? Do we not see? Or we just like to be part of the hype? Just to go against the rulers for the sake of going against them. They're accused of being all types of stuff which they are innocent of, very often. And the issue which concerns us as the person alive does not concern us, is the issue of this grave. That the people keep claiming that they're planning on how to move it. If there's anything that they would have done and that they want to do, but they have not done because of the ignorance of the Muslims all over the world, it's moving that green dome. If anything needs to be moved, it's that green dome, which became a symbol of all types of bid'ah and shirk and nonsense. And they know, but they also know, if you move it, so many ignorant heads around the world will freak out, as if this is an object of worship, as if it is the embodiment of the Messenger of Allah, as if so on and so forth. And it will cause major fitna in the ummah. So they keep it there. Do you think they will move a grave when they have so many Muslims worshiping the grave? They will not. They will not, because of the hadith in Sunan al-Tirmidhi. And this is why I mentioned in the beginning of the khutbah, knowledge is key. Knowledge is key in us knowing how to handle these affairs, how to conduct ourselves, what to say and what not to say. Knowledge is key. The hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha, she said, when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, in spite of those who don't like to hear the word died, when he died, he moved on from this life to the life of the barzakh, the intermediary life between this life and the life to come, where everyone is alive, of course. No one becomes nothing in the grave. There's a punishment in the grave, or there's reward in the grave. So technically, yes, the person is alive, but not the life that communicates with us. That's why we call him dead. When he died, the companions disputed as to where to bury him. Where should we bury Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Abu Bakr interjected and said, radiallahu anhu wa ardah, I heard something from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which I will never forget because of the gravity of the matter and the gravity of the speech. He said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah does not claim the soul of a prophet except in the place in which he wants him to be buried. So he died on the bed, he was buried in the very same spot. And so is the case with every prophet of Allah. Wherever Allah wants him to be buried, Allah takes away their soul. And it ends there, so there'll be no dispute among the followers where to bury him, in this location or that location. That concludes the matter for us until Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allah wanted him to be buried there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Done. So to cause this media war, or to create a media war, or be involved in it, to tarnish the image of the scholars of Saudi Arabia and the rulers of Saudi Arabia and all types of stuff, in order to us to have some hatred, they want to generate this hatred internally, because the only way they can get their way is if the people revolt. And they do this gradually in a subtle way. They always highlight the nasty things, the bad things. Evil people, wallahi. How many times have you seen this image that people post on their Facebook pages or send you on WhatsApp or on an email, whatever, where there are two images, one of a child in Africa dying from starvation and the other one where some rich people from this country have a big old camel or a big old cow or a big old sheep and a lot of rice. And they say, look, look. And they show you the food being thrown in the dumpster. What do they want you to learn? What do they want you to feel? Oh, selfish people. They don't help. Really? If there's anything we cannot deny, is the amount of help that comes from here to the Muslim world in terms of money. But let's assume that didn't take place. Let us assume that didn't take place. And why is it the responsibility of them anyways to take care of the whole ummah? But assume that didn't happen. When do you take an image of a wedding? These are weddings, very often weddings. Have you ever, you yourself, or your family, or anyone you know, had a wedding and brought no food? And when the people came over, you said, "Wallahi, there are people in Africa dying, so I sent the food to Africa to help the kids over there. Ma'alesh, we will fast for the wedding tonight." Really, ya akhi, did you do that? What nonsense! What nonsense! Allah did not place the burden of every Muslim on every Muslim. You're not responsible to pay off all the debts of the Muslims in the world and feed all of them because you have a decent salary. It's not an obligation. If you would like to do it, barakallah fiqh. Live under the line of, you know, decency and give it to the rest. Jazakallah khair. That's your own business. But it's not obligatory on you. It makes no sense to post images like this. An incident where a boy is dying versus an incident where someone is celebrating. We're not endorsing wastage of food and extravagance by all means, no. We know that some of these things are wrong. But that whole concept that they're trying to dish to us is evil. And how many times have you forwarded that? Thinking that you're doing something, a good cause, reminding the people of a good cause. Open your fridge. Check out what's inside. And then let me see you go down to FedEx and ship that food to Africa. No, you didn't do it, I know. So don't expect them to do it. And if you did it, it's not obligatory on them to do it either. This is only an example, my brothers in Islam. It's the same war they're waging against the Hayya today. They love these incidents. They love them, taking them out of context. Where a person from the Hayya might have done something wrong. We don't say they're infallible. They make mistakes, human effort. They get emotional, they get excited. They feel insulted that someone who's not a Muslim is going to come here and handle business according to his own way in this particular country. You cannot go to Britain and do it according to the Saudi way. You have to do it the British way. So then why do you want to come here and do it the British way as well? No, you do it the Saudi way. Otherwise, go back home. Simple. So some people are really just annoying. And that annoying element in them may make someone react negatively or go overboard in reaction, no doubt. But look how this one incident will be used to shut down the system of the Hayya completely. They tried to do it not that long ago when supposedly a car flipped over a bridge and died. And they accused the Hayya of chasing this car. Sure enough, after investigation, it turned out that the people were drunk and the Hayya had nothing to do with it. But at that moment, it was very convenient for that agenda. In order to make you hate the Hayya. So much so that you hear from your fellow Muslims, I hope they remove them. Subhanallah. People that are trying to make sure that the deen of Allah is established on earth, you want them to be removed? What an evil idea. What an evil idea. Even if 50% of them made mistakes, appreciate the other 50%, ya akhi. But it's all part of the same agenda. So be careful. And we will discuss the etiquettes of how a Muslim deals with this information in the second part of the khutbah. I ask Allah to forgive us all. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه. الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد. The Quran laid down a foundation that simplifies all of these issues for us, current, past, and future. It's a principle. If you were to apply it on a personal level, you will save yourself a lot of headache, a lot of sins, and a lot of trials in your life. Take it straight from the speech of your Lord. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا أَن تُصِيبُوا قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ فَتُصْبِحُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلْتُمْ نَادِمِينَ. All you who have believed, when an evil person, when a rebellious person, the Western media, when they bring some news to you, verify it. You must verify it. You don't see an article on the Independent and then you go and put it on your Facebook and spread it among the Muslims. Verify it. Allah told us the wisdom behind that verification. Lest you wind up accusing people wrongfully, which is what is happening now, then you will become regretful over what you have done. So if you were to apply this principle in life, you'll have a peace of mind. And every time I personally have failed in implementing it, I lost my peace of mind. And whenever Allah gives me success to implement it, I have a peace of mind. All you have to do is verify, relax, hold on. Don't start sharing, alatul, sharing. Cross-check with the people that you need to cross-check with. Good news for you. If you don't have anyone to cross-check with, don't do anything. Don't say, well, hopefully it's right. Because you may say, I don't know who to ask. Good news. Don't ask anyone. Don't do anything. Even if the message told you at the bottom, send it to 20 people. Or I will hold you accountable on the day of judgment. I put a trust in your neck that you send this to all your contacts. Send it within the next hour, you will get 10 million blessings. These knowers of the unseen. What if the system was down and WhatsApp was removed from the Google Play Store? You're still going to get a million good deeds? You knower of the unseen? All these stupid messages with the bottom threats. Send it or otherwise. I'm threatening you. You will get this. You will get that. You don't know anything. Don't send anything. 80% of this stuff that we circulate is inauthentic, is misguidance, is darkness upon darkness. And only some are a source of light. Allah will not hold you accountable for not forwarding a message. But Allah will hold you accountable for forwarding a message. If you haven't verified. So you're one of two people. You have means of verification, alhamdulillah, you must verify. You don't have means of verification, don't do anything. But don't be part of that fire. Don't be fuel for that fire. Don't be a reason where you will have to stand before Allah one day and have to explain why you were part of a process that tried to eliminate the peace that Allah has given the Muslims and the security in certain places in the world. Don't be part of that process. That's a big burden on your shoulder that you cannot bear. The sins which we do on our own are between us and Allah. And we ask Allah to forgive and pardon. But those types of sins that impact others, these are grave. They have no solution. Because the people will ask for their right one day. Don't underestimate a message you forward or a post you put. Don't underestimate who reads it, their level of intellect, their level of comprehension, and what reaction takes place with them because of you. Don't underestimate. You don't know how people receive information and how they act upon it. So to conclude, if in 2015 or 1436, better yet, or 1437 or 38, they spread this information again, don't fall for the same trap if you fell for it this year. This is an ongoing situation. It's an annual event now. Sometimes it's hyped up because of the situation of the Muslims more than other years. The grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is where it's supposed to be. Of course, when they expanded the masjid, that area had to be involved in that. But it is not part of the place of worship. Just in case you think it is appropriate to have a grave in the masjid. No, it is inappropriate to have a grave in the masjid. But that happened back then and that cannot be changed now. No masjid should have a grave. But that grave is not like the ones we have in Egypt and Lebanon and some of our countries, where it's a masjid in the middle of the masjid they have a grave. This is a matter of expansion around it, and the hujurat, the chambers, it was still in the chamber. They did not bury him in the masjid, they buried him in the chamber, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the masjid is expanded around that. So this thing should be put to an end once and for all. And the lesson we learn, that this is an indication about what's being plotted against this place. And we have to be careful of being part of this plot. We need to show appreciation when appreciation is due. And we need to understand that perfection was never meant to be on earth. That differing happened from the time of Sahaba. Be realistic. Understand the environment in which you're in. Appreciate. And ask Allah to extend His blessings. And to make them permanent in our lives. And to make us among those who enjoy them in the life to come. Verily is able to do all things. Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub. Thibbit qulubana ala deenik. Allahumma ya musarrif al-qulub. Isrif qulubana ala ta'atik. Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana. وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وصل اللهم وسلم على النبي المختار